Good afternoon. Can everyone hear me? Is the mic coming through? Louder? Okay. Thank you for joining us. My name is Kelly Baum. I'm the Haskell Curator of Modern and Contemporary Art at the Princeton University Art Museum. It's my sincere pleasure to introduce the museum's second, Sarah Lee Elson, Class of 1984, International Artist in Residence, Thomas Hirschhorn. Needless to say, it's impossible to adequately summarize in a few minutes the career of an artist that has spanned almost three decades and that has transformed the field of contemporary art the way Thomas's has. Originally trained as a graphic designer, Thomas began to identify, not without some trepidation, if I understand correctly, as an artist in the late 1980s when he first started making and showing his work. His name is indelibly associated with collage and assemblage, practices he has done more to reanimate than any other artist of his generation. Indeed, Thomas has made the reclamation and recontextualization of found materials, quotidian impoverished materials, the center of his work. He subjects these materials to disquieting transformations that result in both two-dimensional collages made of photographs culled from fashion magazines and the internet, as well as three-dimensional work, displays, comprised of such items as packing tape, foil, crystals, images, mannequins, and cardboard. Some of his displays are immersive, often aggressively so, while others serve as sets for a range of activities. Many are cited in extra artistic spaces, in public spaces, and some are created with the help of the communities that host them over the course of their existence. Thomas has long sought to engage a non-exclusive public, and through his choice of materials and locations, he has done much to level hierarchies and refigure the relationship between art, artist, and viewer. Excess is a defining feature of Thomas's work, excess of objects, commodities, suffering, production, and consumption, as well as precarity, the precarity of materials, but also, perhaps even more importantly, of bodies, of people, of communities. Through his work, Thomas confronts and asks us to confront some of the most troubling events of our age, including war, violence, alienation, and social and economic injustice. Indeed, the word confront occurs frequently in his writing and interviews, along with implicate, energy, will, demand, gift, necessity, truth, and determination. Since the late 1980s, Thomas's work has been featured in countless, probably thousands of exhibitions and sites around the world, most recently at the Venice Biennale. I had the great fortune to see the installation Thomas created for Venice, Crystal of Resistance, in late October. It was extraordinary. The only other visitors to the Biennale that day were a large group of Italian teenagers, who treated much of the sprawling exhibition as if it were an enormous shopping mall. Their gaze was distracted, unfocused. They spent more time on their phones than they did with the art. But these same teenagers underwent a dramatic transformation upon entering Crystal of Resistance. The attention they bestowed on Thomas's complex, demanding installation was both passionate and emphatic. They displayed what I can only describe as commitment, a commitment to seeing and understanding and possibly even disagreeing with the art. It was amazing to watch. There are several people I'd like to thank before relinquishing the podium to Thomas. First, Sarah Elson, class of 1984, who endowed the museum's residency program. I'd also like to thank Tom Leiston and the Department of Art and Archaeology, as well as the staff of the International Sculpture Center, in particular Johanna Hutchinson, Julie Hain, Samantha Rauscher, and Carla Watts, for co-sponsoring Thomas's lecture today. The generosity of the ISC made it possible for us to tape the event this afternoon. From the museum, I'd like to thank James Stewart, our director, Caroline Harris, our curator of education, and also Janet Rauscher, Gary Bloom, and Becky Adamietz-Deo for supporting today's lecture. Hal Foster, Townsend Martin, class of 1917, professor of art and archaeology, deserves special thanks for helping us host Thomas during his visit, as does Sandy Tate. And I should also thank Hal for serving as a respondent after Thomas's lecture today. In addition to the two books he published earlier this year, one on pop art and another on architecture, Hal wrote a tremendous essay on Thomas's work titled Towards a Grammar of Emergency for the catalog that accompanied Crystal of Resistance. Last but not least, I'd like to thank Thomas Hirschhorn for being so generous with his time and energy in the midst of what I imagine is a grueling schedule. We're very grateful to have you with us for these 3 days. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Thomas Hirschhorn.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Kelly, for this introduction. Thank you very much, Hall, for inviting me to come to here. Thank you very much, Sandy and Hall, for hosting me here. Can we please switch down a little bit the light? I do an artist lecture. An artist lecture means I will speak out of my work. I will show pictures, and I try to clarify things. I will do a lecture about my work, last work, Crystal of Resistance. With Crystal of Resistance, I wanted to give a space to resistance. In the beginning of the process, I made this schema. This schema was here to explain first to myself why the form and force fields, love, politics, philosophy, and aesthetics are important to me and how they will find a place in my work. The form and force field, my form and force field, are love, aesthetics, politics, and philosophy. There are other form and force fields, like gender, or nature, or body. But my form and force field are these four. I always want that my work touches each of them, not equally. But I want that my work touches each of them. When I chose my four force and form fields, I was aware about the fact that two of them, philosophy and love, could be more positively loaded. And two of them, and I was aware of them, the form and force field, love, politics and aesthetics could also be loaded negatively. I was aware of them and I was interested to work in this field. Politics, why? Because it's what's touching what is not true, what is not truth. And why aesthetics could be negatively is because it's a question of taste also. With this lecture, I would like to give to myself first answer on the question, how can I, by my work, be in touch with the world? Second, how can I, with my work, create a new world? And third, how can I, in this work, create my own world, a world of my own? This is what I want to test, or I want to clarify with this lecture. How can I, by my work, be in touch with this world? I think through material and the way of production and with the technique of collage. Material, I think it's very important, the question of material, the decision for a material. It's important because this decision has to be done with love, not with a selfish love, but with love as a decision for something, and that's also why I cannot change the materials. For crystal of resistance, I decided to work with the material of a crystal, because his charge, because his mystery, but it also because his universality. Actually, 15 years ago, I went to Switzerland, my home country, underneath the Rhone Gletscher, the Rhone Glacier. And on a parking place, when I want to go home, I saw kids, children, Swiss children, and they presented on a cardboard crystals to sell to the drivers of the cars. And there was marked 1 Swiss franc, 5 Swiss franc, 10 Swiss franc. I was so surprised to see this in Switzerland. And it hurt me, and I loved it. And of course I loved it because to me, it linked these kids, 2 kids in other countries, in other regions of the world. So I decided 15 years ago, once I want to do something with crystals. But crystal also, for his age, each crystal, the quartz crystal one, is between 14 million and 19 million years old. I wanted to work with crystals for its form. Actually, these are not crystals. This is sugar coming from Iran, a sugar stick coming from Iran. And I wanted to work also with crystal because it's the most common mineral, and it is existing on all continents and in a lot of countries. So this is Hans Rufibach. Hans Rufibach is a crystal digger. In the German language, the Swiss German language, it's a very nice word. It's called Strahler. It's very complicated for me to traduce. It means like a beamer. He's a beamer. So it's an activity who beams. So he is in the third generation. His family is a crystal digger. And he told me about the history of his family and how he does exercise his profession. I went with him in this kind of beautiful museums that you can find in the mountains where a crystal digger proposes the crystals. And I had a very interesting, nice discussion about the quality of crystals, because Hans Rufibach, of course, was completely aware about the quality of crystals, the purity of crystals, and what means that a crystal owns more quality than another one. So this bring it to me to engage the discussion with him and to say to him, you know, Hans, I am not interested in the quality. I am interested in the beauty of a crystal. And I would like to tell you now, as I try to tell to Hans, what means the beauty and not the quality. The beauty is, and this is also a reason why I like to work with crystal, is the first crystal you found yourself, for example. I imagine a child who find her or his own first crystal. And this crystal still remains the most beautiful. And I am interested in this. It is beauty of the crystal, not in its quality. So this is why, in my form and force field love, I decided for this exhibition to put the crystal inside. The crystal is not the thematic of my exhibition. The crystal don't stand for resistance. The crystal is not the idea. The crystal is the motif of my work, who through the whole work runs. Another material which I try to use in order to engage the contact with the work is silver paper. Silver paper or aluminium foil you find in the kitchen, but is also used in a high-tech industry. Very early, it's one of the first drawing I made, very early, I decided to cover cardboard panels with silver paper and to put them on the wall in order to create a space for reflection. Material, we are still at material, is also important because the question of material, because it's a property of what you can do with it. And this is actually the picture on the left on the top is not a crystal, it's a concretion. And but of course, with silver paper, its malleability, I can work out easily different forms. Silver paper also for its use still today to isolate things in every day, and also has silver paper for its proper resistance, because when you use silver paper, it's changing its aspect and its surface. That's why I put to these mannequins this kind of vest of suitcases of with silver paper, who make them thicker than they are. Silver paper also because I thought on a discotheque in the countryside, somebody wanted to decorate his discotheque in a countryside. I wanted that my work is including this idea of this country discotheque. Back to the crystal. The crystal has other property I was interested in. And one of these is that it is all the crystals are fragments. It's a fragment. So to me, I wanted to use it in order to understand, to give the understanding at the world as something fragmented. And also, of course, there are other materials. They have this property of being fragmented products or being used as fragmented products. And also, a question of material, I am interested how the material reacts when there is an impact on it or when there is a destruction on it. And that's the reason why in my exhibition I wanted that it reflects this surface where the impact is. So material are also books to me. Very different books. I have the chance to have friends. They send me books. They wrote books. Second, they send books. They send to me books, or they give to me. They give books to me, or also they tell me, look at this book. So books are very important to me. That's a material I'm working with. But also outcome of the book. That's why how I understand the crystal. Outcome of the book, I mean the writing, is a crystal. He is alive. He is growing. And he is organizing himself. And he's resisting. That's why then I found a new material for me. Not in the art, of course, but for me, these are these cotton dubs, for the ears. I'm interested in this material because there is, of course, an universal material, a very common one, and also a material who has these two ends and who allows to build a world, an atom. Yes. That's why I use this material, and this is how I try to engage contact with world. So production in the meaning of how to produce the work. This is also to me, how to produce it. This is also to me a way to engage with the world. and to keep contact with the work. So recently I thought panic. Not panic is not the solution, which I wrote, but panic is the solution. Why? Because in art, it's not about to give the solution, it's about to give a form to the problem. That's what I have to do, to give a form to the problem. And my way to do it is in panic. Panic can help me to give a form to this problem. That could be art. So this is a way to produce. Like somebody who, you know, who is in his car or her car, the mirror is broken. He takes tape, and in panic he fixes it before he goes to the garage. So this is why tape is important to me, not because it holds things together, but it holds things together in a way that you see the excess of it. That's the way how me, I'm self, producing my work. So other books which accompany me in the time of production, and really accompany me. And I show you this, not some friends send it to me, not because they are my sources or because they are a legitimation of my work, but because they are, I feel them like my allies. I'm not alone. I declare they are my allies. That's the way how books are so important to me and how I use the books in my production, in the production phase, actually. So no book is not important. Each book can be important. And nobody can tell me which book must be more or less important for me. So actually in the work, Crystal of Resistance, I made, what you see here on the left is chlorite sand. It's a sand chlorite. Chlorite is a very fine sand, which has the same age like a crystal. Often you find it in a crystal grotto, together with crystals. Sometimes on the crystal, like a sugar on it, or sometimes inside also. So what I wanted to do is to make a kind of aquariums, little aquariums with books, important books to me inside, and on each of the books came out this chlorite sand. And what I wanted in this small world inside, I wanted to create like a reversed chronology. That because either the book of today, a book of today, or even when it's 50 years old, produced this very old chlorite sand, or perhaps the chlorite sand in this aquarium, in this space, closed space, produced the book. That's how I wanted to do this kind of reversed chronology with different books which are all important to me in these aquariums. Another, this is not a book, this is a text of my friend Manuel Joseph, who is a poet. He wrote a text about the precarious, about the precs, the people of the precs, the precarious. And two things are very important in this. Actually, his writing was for a piece of theater, for Theater Precaire I did. So two theses he has, beautiful for me and important for me, about precarious. First, ephemeral is not precarious because the logic of ephemeral is dead. It's the dead. The logic of precarious is not dead, is the suspension, is the moment which you have to be there and to be awake. It's something precious. That's why precarious is an important term to me, and of course not a negative one. And another thing he said, or he wrote, Manuel Joseph, that in the future perhaps in a near or longer future, perhaps the city, the people of the city who today defend themselves from the precs, from the precarious outside, perhaps they get the idea once to change their attitude and to rejoin the precs outside the city, because they did understood that the precs are the in mobility. They have the mobility. They have the real, they have to invent things. They feel what is necessity and not. So this is also, to me, this precarious and the way to work in precarious is a very important issue. And that's why I hope with this to be in touch with the world. And for to go back to my form and force field, it's this precarious, this term of precarious, which in fact is political in the work. Other forms I did precarious is, for example, this one. This I call the crystal bomb. It's just a small structure, a round structure with crystals on it. And from this crystal bomb, there are beams of photographs, and the beams of photographs goes to the wall or to the ground. This way to fix things precarious is to me also to try to be in contact with the world. Another precarious form, I just saw it in the internet on YouTube. It's this kind of, I call it, this kind of poor punching balls. So I saw somebody did at home construct a punching ball with his carpet. And I liked a lot this idea. I liked this idea, to me it was, it gave me the idea to do this sculpture. And I added underneath a recipient, which has crystals inside in order to get the energy, which is done into the punching ball. I'm not alone, of course, to ask me questions about how to produce the exhibition, how to produce the work, how to work this out. So during my preparation, I went to the Natural Historical Museum of Bern, in the city of Bern in Switzerland, and because they made just a purchase of a very big quartz in Switzerland, and I discussed with the curator there, and we exchanged about how to show the crystal. I'm sure his way is not the same than me, but I like that the question of precarious way to show it could be discussed with him. So this is one way to do a crystal myself. I did it with mirrors, and in order that they stand from their own, I needed a lot of packing tape to fix them and to stabilize them. So another way to be in contact with the world is through collage. Through a collage, I love collage. I think it's a never-ending possibility, because what means collage? It means to create a new world from elements of the existing world. And that's why I love doing collage. I love also to doing collage because everybody in his life once did a collage. And before he or she had to get more seriously. So I like that collage is something also sometimes not so serious. So, and I like the collage is over the time still in actuality. But for me, collage is not only to glue things together. I also like to see on pictures of today and to see already in themselves a collage. And myself, I do what I call three-dimensional collages, not only on a paper, but like here, integrated in crystal of resistance. I call it the twin subjector, because there are two mannequins, one very high and another normal high. They are together, they are wearing a clothes, one clothes for these two people, and on this clothes were people of conflict situation of the world. And the discs, these plates, to me this is also a collage, because it's only a piece of cardboard covered by silver paper. And I saw this picture of this young child who to me does work out this kind of collage in a form of resistance. To me, do a collage is to try to show the real of the reality. The real of the, not two realities, the real of the reality. That I think I can do with a collage. The real of the reality. So like here, this is a three-dimensional collage. It's a part of my exhibition. It's mannequins. I pull out like an ingrow, something who is growing, but in, where is growing inside, and I put crystals into their bodies. Collage also on the left side. On the left side, you see, it's there are the 34 books. There's 34 books. They helped me. They were my allies in this work, Crystal of Resistance. For one of the reasons they were important to me, and I like to do this kind of book list. Because also this is a collage, because they're very different books there. On the right side, the Crystal World, the book of Crystal World, I think it's you, Hall, who spoke about this. And just I want to say how I work. When I told you, Hall, about my work, you mentioned this book. I did not know it before, so I bought it. And I didn't open it. I just opened it when I was in Venice working on my work there. And then I discovered that in this fantastic book, science fiction book, very important book for science fiction, so that there's something described could be in comparison to what I tried to do. So what I tried to do is to create a space for reflection of today. And what I wanted to do is to create the time for this, the time for it. That's why the space was so important to me. So to respond, how can I, with my work, create a new world through materials, through production, with collage? I can create, I think, a non-exclusive audience, non-exclusive public. This was already mentioned by Kelly. I would like to tell you what I mean with this. So the important thing is the arrow who goes from the artist to the other, or what I call the non-exclusive audience. This is for me a schema I have in my mind as an artist. I always think on it, each exhibition. So in the public space, but also in a museum, in a gallery, I thought on this. So important to me is that my work is directed to this other, the one who I don't know, the one who I don't expect, the one who don't care about art, the one who is hostile perhaps about art, but my neighbor perhaps. So this is the other. This is very important. I only want to direct the work on this. And of course, this other, he judge my work directly. But as you see, there is another bulb, and what's very important to me, that in the other the circle, I call it the spectre of evaluation, is touching the other, and also it's overlapping it, of course, because when I want to do a non-exclusive audience, I don't want to exclude anybody. But important to me is not to direct my work to what I call the specter of evaluation. The specter of evaluation is the institution director, the art critic, the curator, the gallerist, the art historian, the collector, the art professor. They are included to me in the non-exclusive audience. But I cannot, I believe, as an artist, direct my work towards them because they only evaluate it. So how can I, with my work, create a new world with a position, I believe, with an assertion, and through a conflict? Position, I think this is important to have a position. I don't want to work it more out than I can. So one question. How can I take a position, and how, this is my problem. How can I give a form to this position? This is my problem as an artist. Not only have a position, but only give a form to it. This is my big problem. So that's what I try to do. In the exhibition, Crystal of Resistance, and this is one thing I liked a lot in this proposition of a pavilion, there is the possibility to make a free flyer for everybody. And on this free flyer, there is only my text. It was not an explication about my work, so it was only my declaration, what I wanted to do. So people could take it for free and could check my position with what they saw. I told you in the beginning, I wanted to create a space for resistance, but not for resistance against something specific, against the oppressor, resistance against consumption, against the world and the dictatorship even of information today, but resistance as such. That's what I wanted. Resistance as such, because I believe that art is resistance as such. So of course, but then of course, there are other books I like and I carry with me. There are books because they are carrying an idea. Even when I'm not agree 100% with this idea or even not or less, but there is an idea. That's why I made a chandelier with them, and in order to tell you what I mean to work out a form, outcoming of a position, in this preparation drawing, I wanted to use the crystal and the universe of facts where we are living inside to show this. So there is a structure, and on the top of the structure are crystals. And as we know, the crystal needs a material to grow, to eat, and to drink, and to grow, and to live. So I covered the bottom with two kinds of facts or informations. The kind of more people information, and another one with more political and more fact information. My idea was again to do a kind of reversed dynamic, that the crystal is taking his energy out of the fact of today in order to go through to them. So this is what I wanted to do. This is what I, you know, this is the form I wanted to do to my position against the world of facts we are inside. The crystal here, in this element, represents the truth who comes through this, who comes out through this universe or texture of facts. Yes, and this is the part, philosophy, form and force field, the part philosophy, who is constructed by first the belief that art is resistance, but also the knowledge, the knowledge that it is like this, and this build together the conviction that art is resistance as such, and that I is the philosophical part in this work. Assertion is very important issue as well. I believe as an artist that it's about to assert a form. I believe this. I need to assert for. So, for example, to clarify this, in Crystal of Resistance are two elements where I try to give form to this assertion. So one is the form for the divinities, and the other for the people, for the profound people on the ground. So this is the forms that these receptors people does to collect energy, to collect water, to do themselves when they're in the desert, for example. So they are forms made by my materials, but they are made by humans for humans, but with a kind of divine inspiration. So this is a kind of assertion of form. These receptors for who has this human, I mean this earth, this earth connected form. And then I decided to do other elements for the divinities, and these elements are the tears surrounded by silver paper. They have no use for us on the earth, but they have a use for a divinity who could check that this is a wooden palette, but not for the use that we wanted to use. The same with the car seats I covered with silver paper, and the gym elements we are covered for with silver paper. And also the mattress, which are covered with silver paper. In order to create a new world, a friend sent me a beautiful sentence. The crystal grows in blind material. It is not meant for the theater of the eye. The crystal resists visibility. And of course it touches absolutely what I wanted. And this friend goes far away and thought the crystal could be a monument for the thinking of Edouard Glissant of the right to opacity. This is, to me, an assertion to use, actually, Edouard Glissant. It's an assertion of mine. I discovered it during the project of Crystal of Resistance. Edouard Glissant is a thinker of the creolity, is a French, in French Antille, in the French Antille, he worked worked as a poet, as a philosopher, as on the concept of emancipation of his people. So I was interested in this right to opacity, and I took it deliberately out of the context, of Edouard Glissant. So this is my right to opacity. I took four citations, all from Edouard Glissant. We demand for all the right to opacity. You must fight against transparent everywhere. The other is in me because I am me. Equally, the I from the other is absent, perishes. And the last one, you have the right not to be understood. So these kind of assertions I took out of the context helped me, I want that they help me to put my world in the existing world through, of course, a conflict, because this is always a conflictual situation. So on the line between the facts, the information, the comments towards the resistance, there are two issues, one violence and the other creation. And I'm interested in both creation and violence, and because I think they could work out a new form. So I wanted to show this with using communication materials who are occupied by crystals, or cellular phone who each owns their own crystal, of course, because it's a try to work out this idea to go beyond, to have his own profile, to go behind the obsession to communicate, and also to go behind the obsession to present yourself. Another form is the, I call it Nasdaq crystal. I used this kind of, on the stock exchange, this kind of structure who I saw like a crystal themselves, or a crystalline form. I made a tower out of 54 video screens, which were enlarged in the top. This was my Nasdaq tower, and on all of these 54 video screens, I put a picture of a destroyed body, people in a conflict situation, but there were no photographs. There were I put them on an iPad, and there was a hand in this very typical and very new movement to switch pictures, to stop it, to enlarge them, to let them go away and to come back. In this movement, I wanted to confront the incommensurable with a very dense and very close proximity. I call this part of my work touching reality. So how can I, with my work, create a new world, with a position, with assertion, through a conflict? And this is one of my ambition: create a critical corpus. A critical corpus, what is important to me is here the corpus, not the critical. The critical is important, but what is important, I need a corpus for the critical. I need a corpus to criticize, but also a corpus to be criticized. And I need a corpus to be in a critical situation. And that's what I want to do with my work. I want to put them in a critical situation. That's also why the catalog I had the occasion to do was not, of course, dealing with my exhibition, but with my previous works, and I gave him the title Establishing a Critical Corpus. So the last question is, how can I, in this world, create a world of my own, my world? So I think with a setup of my world, with the idea of giving a form, and through to use art as a tool or a weapon to confront the world, to confront the time I'm living in, and to confront reality. So set up my world, I understand it, and I want to show you this picture. On this picture on the top, on the left, this is a man, he's in his world. This is I look to these pictures. You know, when I'm preparing my work, I surround myself by picture. And this is the world. This is what, not this world, but this is a world of somebody. This man, he's making on his table his world. And I'm interested in doing this as well. Other pictures of worlds of somebody, which interest me and which I wanted to have as an encouragement to do my work. So in the Swiss pavilion, which is a construction of the 50s, separated in actually four parts. There is a part for painting, there is a part for sculpture, and because sculpture is outside and inside, there is a part sculpture inside and a part sculpture outside, and then there is a fourth part is for graphics or for prints. So, and there is an inner court. So this was clear for me from the beginning that my world I want to do my work in this pavilion, specific pavilion space, as not an in situ project, but using completely the space available. And I wanted to do it with a throughway, a completely throughway, that you can go through, in, and go back. So, because they have an inner court, with a tree, I needed to cover the space, so we made it a roof in order to have more space. And in the big space, the space dedicated to the painting, I asked for making a mezzanine, because when you have not enough space, what you're doing a mezzanine. But also it's good to have something who destructurate the place again. So we did for the pavilion mezzanine. So the idea was, I wanted that the people goes into the pavilion, and behind the question of representation of countries, pavilions, etc., I just wanted that the people enter into my brain, and when they go out, I wanted that a part of my brain is still in their brain. So this was the guideline. Give form, also to an important term to me in order to establish my world. Give form means not making form, give form means to really give it. So this is a picture which was really inspiring me. It's the picture of this grotto, this crystal grotto in Naica, in Mexico, which was discovered 15 years ago, with these huge crystals, 12 meter long. So this was something I wanted to express as well in my idea of giving form, that a crystal is not only one dimension, has different and a lot of dimensions. So that's why in my work, crystal of resistance are very, very tall, very big crystals. But also because I wanted that with these big forms, I call them mega forms, and I'm still in the meaning to give a form in order to create my world, is the idea of these mega forms is to break the angles, to break the spaces, that the spectator has still to find another point of view. And the same, and this is an early drawing, the same I wanted to do with the light into the pavilion. I wanted in this pavilion a lot of light. I wanted just a lot of light, different light, neon light, spotlight, and also natural light. Because I made these light wells. You see on the right side, there's a kind of tube, it's natural light, because I didn't want to annulate the space. I just wanted to annulate the Giardini, the Venice, etc. I didn't want to avoid the possibility to think on light. And also the light is so important to me, because I want that the things are shining in a new light. That's why it's so important to have all this different light into my work. So another form in giving form was the decision for the chairs. This is a preparation drawing with a waiting room. I liked the idea of a waiting room, because there is in the universal, but also in a waiting room there is a kind of vacuum of time. So that's why in my work every element is on a chair, on a plastic chair. I thought for this idea, of course, of waiting and age, but also, you know, as an artist, as a sculptor, I'm interested in creating like of problems that allows me or forces me to follow a logic, and the logic was to put everything on these chairs. And this is about the forms I saw with this drug crystal net, and there are some pictures out of crystal net laboratories. I show it to you because I made a part in Crystal of Resistance who wanted to take over this aesthetic, because it's about the aesthetic, and I wanted in a way to recuperate or to reappropriate my aesthetic outcome of this crystal met laboratories. So this is the last form and force field part, the aesthetic one, and the aesthetic one responds to the question how it looks like, how the visual aspect is of this work. This is the aesthetic, only the aesthetic part. The tool and the weapon, I told you, that's my understanding as of art. There are two other books I get as a gift. On the right side, Bergkristall, the crystal from the mountains. It's a novel of Adalbert Stifter. It's a very simple novel. On the left side, you see the novel Bergkristall is a content of the other one, of the bigger one, Buntestein. So why I was interested? Because this novel of Adalbert Stifter is a novel about a young boy and a young girl. They are brother and sisters. They are going into the mountains and they are lost. And then the day is going down. And in order to save their lives, they have to find a refuge. And actually, they did find a grotto with stones inside, a crystal grotto, actually. That's why it's called the Bergkristall. What is interesting in this novel, very simple novel, is that the kids didn't know that it's Bergkristall, and Adalbert Stifter never mentioned crystal. I like a lot this kind of avoiding to mention the crystal, because the kids only used this grotto as a shelter. Next day they were saved. So this gave me the idea to do a model, a kind of model of it. I call it my étant donné. And the model was outcoming of my visit to the Natural Historical Museum in Bern, because there they have a marmot. They were trying to show that marmots often in the mountains find refuge in a crystal grotto. And I thought, this is the point I'm interested in, to put a marmot as a model to, for what? As a model to live in this world, in this incommensurable world. In this world, who can be the shelter of mine, and who can make it that I can survive in this world? In this world, also apart or with all the facts and all the elements, which the marmot also don't understand, but need it as a bed. So this is why I made this model, and then I made another one just with an eagle, in order also to have this other part of the element, which is the sky, inside. In this. So that's why I understood this as the idea of a tool, a weapon, to work out this idea of resistance. And finally, how can I, in this world, create a world of my own, my world. I told you, with this idea of the setup, my world, with the idea of giving form, and through, and convinced that art is a tool in order to create a new term. And of course, this is my as an artist, like I believe for every artist, my ambition is to create a new term of art. Thank you.
Don't worry, I don't have a response. That's an impossible act to follow, and I won't try. I also had no idea what Thomas would talk about. But I do have a few questions, and I just want my questions to give you time enough to think about your own. So this is not a test. One thing that I think is so extraordinary about this man and this work is that he forces together terms, concepts that many of us, at least people like me, want to hold apart often, like aesthetics and politics. He refuses them to be antinomic. But there are a few collisions in this project and in your talk that I wanted to ask you about. But first, let me ask you about materials. The crystal obviously has so many associations, and you bring in so many other ones. I mean, it has utopian associations. You think of the glass chain, letters of architecture, you know, think of Kristallnacht for dystopian associations. I guess my question is, when is too much too much? I mean, one of your slogans that you love is more is more. I mean, you want nothing to do with the old modernist aesthetic of less is more. And you've also talked about your materials as materials found in the capitalist garbage bucket. But when is your strategy of excess a critique of the given excess that is out there? And when is it just a redoubling, a confirmation of this very excess?
It's never too much. It's never too much. This is really the point. I don't say that for the spectator or for the viewer or for the reception, I can control this, or I cannot put it myself in the mind of the viewer to say now it's enough, because this is what I don't want to say, it's enough now, you know, because it means to have the control about things. So, but I have not the control about it, and I know what you mean. I understand what you say, and I think it's never a confirmation of the society we are living inside, because it's not made with the will to confirm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. That pause was to signal that I wasn't completely satisfied with this response. Another opposition. Another cliche.
Now, can I look? The problem is when I should say now it's enough, or you know, when I should quantify it, then I am in this what I don't want, in this aesthetic I'm not interested, because then it's just an aesthetic question. It's like somebody who decorates the house and say now there is a chair too much, or the carpet is too small, you know, but I don't know on what it is based. And that's why I think it's never a confirmation, because perhaps it can happen that it doesn't work, of course, also to my work. It can happen that it doesn't work, what I wanted to do. But I cannot make this depending to my judgment, aesthetical judgment. I cannot do it. I can only base it on my will.
Right. So you don't want there to be a moment of control or distance, but and this is also why it's very difficult, I think, sometimes to think about your work, because you actually take terms like the aesthetic or like evaluation, like judgment, and you want to re-signify it. You want to re-function them. And so as we listen to you, it's, you know, we have our own associations, and we go with you as you redirect them. But I mean, this is really the nature of my questioning, because you know, your project in many ways seems to be to repurpose terms. I mean, terms that we all use, and that's where the confusion lies. But let me try another opposition. I love this line from Glissant that you affirm the right to opacity, and crystals are perfect. I mean, they're transparent and they're opaque. They, you know, they embody the kind of utopia of transparency, but they allow for mystery, the wonder of the kid, and, you know, that first crystal. So there's the right to opacity, which has all kinds of political implications. But then there's also the assertion, and Kelly cited it too, the ultimate value of the non-exclusive public. So how do you reconcile right to opacity and the communication that enables that non-exclusive public?
Well, first of all, you know, that's what I told you, that's an artist lecture. Because the artist not only shows his work, but also he tries to clarify his work, but also, and I try it, to use I cannot say his own terms, because that's the same terms he or you use also, but in another way. But it's very important that as an artist, I'm not first, when I'm using a term, looking what is the definition of this term in art history, because then I'm lost. I mean, then it does not make sense to work, because I am not in the analysis of my work, and I am in the problem of do my work. So I accept completely this confusion. And perhaps this is also a little bit a try to respond on your question about the non-exclusive audience and the right to opacity. Because to me, as simple as it is to write the sentence of Edouard Glissant, the right to opacity, is of course what I liked inside, is there are different layers. There is a first layer, you can use it very simply as a kind of appeal to not discover everything, for example. But then behind, when you think on it, and I have confidence that you can think on them, because it's something very strong and very, very simple. So there are other layers. And then you can, I think, I hope, and this is why I'm including the non-exclusive audience in this, because I don't reduce the non-exclusive audience only on the possibility to read it in the first degree, because they can also read it in the second degree, the third degree, etc.
And maybe I am in a position where I want to resolve contradictions, and you want to present them and to pressure them. I mean, I was really taken by your definition of your production, which is to give form to a problem as opposed to solve a problem. And I connected that then with your preferred medium of collage, and you defined the desire, the goal of your collage is just to reveal the real of reality. And it, I mean, I'm not sure that this is a question, but we often think about art as a resolution to a problem, a resolution to a contradiction. And I think what your work does, you know, from its insistence on the fragment to its its practice of collage and assemblage is to refuse that moment of resolution. And this idea of collage as the real of reality, or of the reality, it's hard for me not to hear a psychoanalytic valence, you know, that the real is really the traumatic real of history, or the traumatic real of a reality that we can't see, the way that at least Americans were not allowed to see the representations of those obliterated bodies of the Iraqi. And I think that's really, an extraordinary practice. I mean, I can't think of another practice that is so insistent on a refusal to resolve or to reconcile. And I don't know, though, how to reconcile that with your idea that your art is still a space for reflection. But I won't ask that as a question. I'll just let that hang. But please, you must have questions and comments, so step up, be brave. Sure, Ibra. But do speak up, I think.
Sure. Yeah. This is maybe related to the question about the two terms that might be held in tension versus resolution, but I was really interested, maybe this has something to do with the kind of PowerPoint presentation, of the kind of logical way in which you carried us through your practice, kind of subsets. And I was interested in the relation or seeming contradiction between that very kind of logical coherency and this idea that's so manifest in your work of excess. And if you could speak at all to the relationship between a kind of logic and a kind of excess, I think that threaded through your talk today. That just struck me as something really
interesting. Yeah, but that's not a contradiction to me, or when it is, that's the logic. Excess, you know, that's the logic. Logic means not, I am for to be precise, you know, I am for to be really precise, everything. I try to do it, but preciseness, logic is not the aesthetic of it, you know. It looks like it's logic. It looks like it is precise. No, the preciseness and the logic has its own, so I see it. They're inhabited by it. So it doesn't have to look like it is precise when it is precise. So this is very important to me, and I'm ready to pay the price for this confusion. I must say, as I told in the beginning, this is a lecture about a work I made. I made the lecture after. Why I made it after? To clarify things. Because when I'm inside, and that's also why I told about panic, for example, the precarious situation, the situation of a catastrophe, the situation of something you are overwhelmed. Every artist knows this. It's not new. But to try to accept it and to try to integrate it even. So the pictures and the sentences I worked out is to understand in this logic I have, and in this decision to do it with excess, but not in the same moment, but after, to make it, to keep the clearness, to get the clearness how I did it, how in this headlessness, in this acceleration, I worked out the form. So I cannot do it in the moment, because then I really am in panic. I can only do it after, to try to understand how I did it. And I think, and this is important to me.
Another question, please.
You talked about creating a space for reflection, also creating a time for reflection, and about experiencing your work in person. To me, it seems like the like the panic energy and like the excess combined to like create time. So like a lot of like the energy of the panic being kind of like compressed by like the excess of it creates time. Are there other, do you see like other things in your work that, are there other factors that you use to create time?
Yes. People always say, a lot of people say, he does, meaning me, installations. I don't do an installation. What I want is to create time, to do a work which is dense, which is charged, I mean, this is my idea, and where are a lot of things. And it's not important that you have to see them all or to read them all. That's not the importance. But there is, I mean, I try it like this, you know, this is my idea, to create time, to create, not that you have to give time, no, no, but that you come in and you think on something as a dimension of the time, the past time, the suspended time, or the future time. So that's how, why it's, for example, important to go on the top roof, to close it, you know, to make all the work, to give them this aspect that everything is not made to make it as a grotto or an installation, but for the reason that there is another dimension I wanted to touch, and this is time. Of course, a relation.
Expenditure.
Yes, I see the relation. But the time. I mean, I try it to be clear. Why love? Why? Where I thought this is my form and force field, love, and or why the material, the true, the design for the material is so important. But excess, the excess has to mean, it's not for me. It's not in the same form and force field. The excess is in the same of. In the force and for and form field of politics, you know. That's also why it's possible to see it dark, you know, in the dark part. You can put it in the dark part. It's okay to me, you know. People say, yeah, he's obsessive or he can't stop or it's always too much. So okay, I accept it because there's the dark part, you know. So you know, that's why I. For me, excess is in the part politics.
Ariel, do you have a question?
Yeah, you spoke about the flyer as a supplemental material. I want to ask you about the website for Crystal of Resistance. If it's a clarification of the work, like the lecture or insertion of your position, and why are you taking it down at the end of January?
Yeah, so the flyer is for the people who comes in and goes out with something and they take a flyer as a gesture, normal gesture, because it's free. And I like this because it's a possibility to make a statement. And when there is time, once later perhaps, you can read it. So it's an offer. The website, I wanted to do it for the people, they don't go to Venice. You know, it's not an interactive website. It's important. It's just an information. It's just material downloaded. You can also download pictures, for example. So it's just a material. It's the material, the accumulation. And I wanted to, and I didn't give them, an interactivity option. Yes, I just wanted to make the website for the people who don't go to Venice, actually. You know, and don't. Can go, so they can, with this tool, they can have an idea of my work. And I want to shoot it down, because I think there is no reason to have it longer there, because the work is also down, dismantled, so I think now also there is no more reason to aliment it. For example, after I alimented it with critiques, first with photo of the setup, then photo of the work, with text, etc., then with critiques about the work. Every critique I could find, I put in. So there is no reason to aliment it again. So that's why I think it's good also to finish with it and to shoot it down.
Rachel?
Yeah, I have a question, and I'm almost embarrassed to admit it, but it's about the marmot. And the question is this, and I take the marmot seriously, and this is why I'm asking this question. It seems to me, I didn't see the project in Venice, but it seems to me that given what I've read and given what you've said today, that the bulk of the material used or deployed in the project has something to do with the human. So we might call the human as the chief organizing or chief category, the chief organizing term of the chief category. So I mean, you're talking about resistance. The objects and artifacts you use are related to the human. You're interested in the humor, and you're also interested in yourself as a human. What happens with the marmot that's really interesting to me, which clearly comes from the Bergkristall novel, is that all of a sudden that term drops out, the human drops out, and the organizing term of the chief category of experience is the animal. And I'm wondering what the animal gets you in the larger context of something that we might call a complex of the human.
I have such a good answer for that. Sorry.
I promise no making joke. So look, to me, in this novel, it's not about the animal, it's about the kids, the two, the brother and the sister. And I just wanted to show this. So, you know, this novel, I wanted to, that's why I told you it's a model. It's a model. So a model is not, it's a model of it. So I made a model. And because there is this marmot. I mean, I didn't invent it. I saw it in the Natural History Museum. So that's important because I thought, somebody else did it. I mean, there are people, serious people, mineralogical people. So they tried this marmot. So I thought, and because it's an animal, and in a way we can see, it's a living animal, and now it's dead, but I mean, this marmot now. So it's replace the two children. You understand? Yeah, I'm not agree with you, and I don't. You make a kind of how about this? The name? You propose me a deal. I'm not agree with the deal. When I say it's incidental, then it's okay. No, it's not incidental. But I think your thought about the marmot goes too far.
That's fine.
I don't say that I didn't thought on it, but that's also why, for example, in the crystal grotto is another element which was not in the crystal grotto of the Adalbert Stifter novel. It's the newspapers, the magazines. Yes, so I added this. When you want human element inside, because I I know what you mean, and you're not wrong, but I give in this grotto a tool to also connect it to the human, beside that the marmot and the eagle are also animals as us.
You know, I think there's a reception in the museum, and I don't want to keep you too long from the reception. Maybe one or should we do one or two more questions? Joe?
Thomas, thanks for coming to Princeton. I wondered if you might just say more about the importance of being unreasonable, because that's what I've always enjoyed about your work, is just this, it's an emotional, or it's just an atmosphere of, I will not relent, or I will not behave, and I just like that atmosphere very much. Is it important to be unreasonable to you? Is that a mischaracterization?
Yes, but I understand what you mean. I am for headlessness. Why? Because it's not to be reasonable or not reasonable. It means I'm interested in acting, okay? And I want to act unreasonable when you want, or I want to act with headlessness, with headless. But I want to act, you know? So this is why your definition of reasonable is to me too much not dynamic and not, not active. So, because I want to be active. But then when I'm active, that's true. I want to be active headless. Because I think this is a way to engage with for what I'm competent of. I'm competent to not understand the world. You know, I'm competent to face something is incommensurable to me. I'm competent to make open my eyes and to face things that I can't understand, and that I can do with headlessness only.
One more question, Griffin.
Yeah, I mean, I really developed this kind of idea for me, the two to the three dimensional, with a lot of time, with about years, you know. I started really with collages, and then I put them in books, and then they grow, and then I made, they really in the time they grow, but it's not what you really want to know, I understand, but when I'm working now, it's immediately. So I see it immediately as a collage things, you know. And this is what I actually want to pursue, to see the world as a big collage, and also as a three-dimensional, as a two-dimensional. That's not more important, but. Why I'm so interested in collage, and to come also a little bit back what you mentioned in the beginning, that this is not a montage, it's a collage, okay? So, and when I insist on the word of real, yes, into the reality, is that I take two things or more than, of course, and there I don't transform them, not like in a montage, where I try, for example, to be simple, to reduce something in order to make them more or less the same level or the same size. So I use, and this is the real in the reality. I use without reducing, without making them bigger, without putting color or not color things together. And then they get something new or something again. So this is, to me, you know, it's like a decision. So that's why it's not a long process of work. This is a decision, this is like, it's immediate. I can only answer this to you. It's immediate.
There are two examples of the Ur collages in the museum that the museum has purchased, and Kelly has put them in a quite extraordinary arrangement with other related works. So I encourage you to go see them and invite you all on behalf of the museum to a reception for Thomas. And thank you very much.
Thank you.